If you're having trouble making your composites look realistic, make sure to check out this video. I will go through 7 compositing tips and tricks that I'm sure you'll love. Let's jump right into the tutorial. Getting the lighting right in a composite can be a difficult task. In this next tip, I'm going to show you how to add rim lighting to images that don't have it. In this composite, I have a cool background with a light source on the top right, and I've done everything I could to color match this image. I've applied the right brightness, saturation, and hue, but the image still doesn't look realistic, and the reason is that I'm not getting the right highlights on her body that would appear if this was a real photo. So if your image doesn't have a rim light, what you need to do is take it from somewhere else. In this case, I'll use this photo of this couple working out. Look at the rim light on her right arm. We can take that and place it in our composite. To do so, select the lasso tool and make a loose selection around her arm. Then press Ctrl+C on Windows, Command+C on the Mac to copy. I'll come back into my working composite. And I'm going to press Ctrl+V on Windows, Command+V on the Mac to paste. And this is the highlight that we're going to use on her arm. I'll press Ctrl+T, Command+T to transform. Make sure that you check this box so that you can see the pivot point. And make sure that you place the reference point on her shoulder. And that's going to be the reference for my composite. I'm also going to reduce the opacity so I can see the layers below. And I'm going to click and drag while holding Shift to scale from that point. And I'm just trying to get it large enough so that it covers that entire arm, like so. It won't be a perfect match, but that's okay. And what I'm gonna do is place this highlight as best as I can over the original arm, and I can continue scaling if I need to. I think something like this should work. Then I'm going to increase the opacity back to 100%, and I'll desaturate the layer by pressing Ctrl+Shift+U on Windows. That's Command+Shift+U on the Mac. And I'm gonna go into Filter, Liquify. From the Liquify filter, I'm going to collapse all these panels since I don't need them. And the panel that I do wanna see is the View Options panel. From here, make sure that you enable a Show Backdrop, and where it says Use, you can select your woman layer, like so. Then you can zoom in and just make sure that the arm matches as best as possible. Again, you don't have to be perfect, but just get it close enough. The trick here is to use a large brush and push the pixels in as best as you can, like so. Just make sure that it covers the entire arm, and I think that this will be good. It's not perfect, but it should work. I'm going to press OK. Photoshop will make that distortion. Then I can change the blending mode to screen, and I'll call the layer Rim Light. Next, I'll open up my group and place the layer right above my woman layer, like so. It is clipped to the layer below so that the edges are defined by the actual arm. What I'm going to do now is adjust the brightness of this rim light layer so that the only thing that is visible is the highlight and not the rest of the arm. So you can go into Image, Adjustment Levels, and just darken up the image by clicking and dragging on this black point like so. And notice how this is looking much more realistic now. And I can drag this to the left, and you can fine tune the highlight accordingly to get a realistic result. You can press OK when you're done. At this point, all you need to do is fine tune the details. For example, you can select the Move tool and move the arm around if need be so that it matches better. You can also press Ctrl+T, Command+T to transform, and you can scale it up and keep moving it so that it matches as best as possible. Then you can create a layer mask and paint with black on that layer mask and hide the unnecessary areas. And by using this technique, you can apply realistic rim lights to your composites. This is what my result looks like when I've applied the same technique to both arms, her face, and her hair. And this is what it looks like after I've applied a global color grade. Sometimes when you create a mask, you might get these white outlines known as fringing around your subject. They're really annoying, but with this technique, you should be able to remove them fairly quickly. I'll double click on the hand tool to fit the image to screen, and I'll select this soccer player's layer mask. I can disable it by clicking on it and holding Shift. And to remove the fringing, go into Filter, Other, and select Minimum. And that'll take us into this dialog box that is designed to contract masks. The great thing about the minimum filter is that you're not stuck with whole numbers. You can use decimal points when adjusting the radius to give you much more control when you contract your mask. And also, there's two different algorithms that we can use, roundness and squaredness. In this case, we'll go with roundness because we're working with an organic object, a person, so there's no sharp edges or straight edges. In this case, a radius of 1 should work, and I'll press OK. And notice that the white fringing is now gone. Another great thing about this filter is that you can selectively apply it to areas of your mask. You can do so by selecting the lasso tool, then freehand the selection around the black outline on his arm. Next, go into Filter, Other, Minimum, and again, a radius of 1 should work. Notice how that black line disappears without affecting the rest of the mask. Remember, if you're enjoying these techniques, make sure to click on that like button. One of the most often overlooked principles in compositing is matching the ambient color. Let me show you an amazing technique so that you can easily match the ambient color of all the objects in your composites. First, go into the new adjustment layer icon and create a new color fill layer. Then I'll select a 50% gray. You don't have to be exact, as long as it's close to 50%, it should work. Press OK. Then change the blending mode from normal to luminosity. This will make all the luminance values in the composite the same, and the hue of each item will be more noticeable. If it's not noticeable, you can go and create a hue and saturation adjustment layer and increase the saturation. I'm going to place these two layers into a group. I'll hold Shift, click on both, then press Ctrl G on Windows, Command G on the Mac. And this is my ambient color check. And from here, you can see the ambient color on the image. Notice that our astronaut suit is white, but there's actually some color hidden in there. When I enable this, you can see that we have a lot of magenta, in some cases oranges, yellow, and even green. So what we need to do is make sure that the ambient color of our scene matches the foreground. In this case, notice how most of the background has a blue tint to it, so we need to match that onto our astronaut so that the composite looks realistic. So I'll select my astronaut, then I'll create a selective color adjustment layer, then click on this icon to clip it to the layer below so that this adjustment layer only affects the astronaut. Then from the colors dropdown, select neutrals. And now we need to make sure that the astronaut's color matches the background. I'll start by adding a little bit of cyan, which will cool the astronaut, which is exactly what we want. Notice that we have a lot of magenta, so I'll reduce magenta to add green. Then I'll reduce yellow to add blue. And notice that this is looking much, much better now. The foreground is actually matching the background. I can also adjust the whites. Most of his suit is white, so we need to adjust it so that there's no other hues in there. So I'll reduce the magenta on his suit, and it will turn blue. I can also reduce the yellow to make it even more blue. Then I can go into the blacks, and you'll see the areas on his glove and his helmet change when I add a little bit of cyan and reduce the yellow, like so. Notice that this matches the background much better now, and when I disable the ambient color check layers, you can see the result. This is before and after. So always make sure that the ambient color matches so that your composites look more realistic. By the way, if color is important to you, then make sure to check out the MSI Creator 15 laptop, which features MSI's exclusive True Pixel display, which is a combination of several features specifically designed for creative pros to get the best colors possible. These features include a 4K display at 220 ppi for great on-screen detail that can reproduce Adobe RGB at 100%. Also included is the True Color technology, which ensures color accuracy so that your work is displayed exactly as you intend. MSI calibrates all Creator 15 laptops at the factory, and they're Kalman certified. You'll get excellent color representation, which is necessary for creative work. MSI Creator laptops are tested and optimized to run Adobe software, including Photoshop, Premiere, Illustrator, and many others. It gives you the peace of mind that your laptop is fully compatible and it will perform efficiently with your favorite design apps. If you want to find out more about the MSI Creator 15, then check out the link below in the description. But anyway, let's jump right back into the tutorial. Have you ever had a composite that doesn't quite match the background? In most cases, it happens because you did not take perspective into account when placing elements into your background image. Let me show you how you can find perspective in a photo and how you can use perspective to composite in other elements. In this background image, you can see that we have receding lines. These parallel converging lines all lead to a vanishing point on the horizon line. You can then select the line tool and click and drag on these parallel converging lines and follow them and see where they meet. I'll start with this line here, then I'll hold Shift and I'll start drawing a new line, and I'll release the Shift key once I've started drawing it. That way I can draw it in the same layer. and follow it all the way through, and you'll notice they meet right about here. And if I click and drag from that point, you'll see that all the lines on my background recede into that vanishing point. And that vanishing point will sit on the horizon line. So my horizon line is on this area. I can click and drag a guide down and place this guide so that I know where my horizon line is. If you don't see your rulers, you can press Control R on Windows, Command R on the Mac. And one way of figuring out where the horizon line is without tracing parallel converging lines is to look at your image and see if you can figure out where the ground plane meets the sky. The place where they meet will be where the horizon line is. Now that I know where the horizon line is, I can enable my model layer, and I'll disable the layer mask by holding shift and clicking on the layer mask thumbnail. And notice that this image also has parallel converging lines, so you can follow the parallel converging lines on this image to find where the horizon line is. And it's right here, right next to her hips. So I'll delete the line layer since we don't need them. I'll hold shift and click on the layer mask to bring it back. I'll select the move tool and I'll move the model group directly over my composite so that both horizon lines match, making the composite look and feel more realistic. And you don't have to be precise. You can move the model up or down just a bit. As long as you're within that range, your composite should work. One of the most difficult things to do in Photoshop is mask hair from busy backgrounds. Let me show you a wonderful technique that will help you in these situations so that your composites look more realistic. First of all, I'm going to select my foreground layer and I'm going to click on the Remove Background button. This will use Adobe Sensei machine learning technology to analyze your photo, make a selection out of the main subject, and apply a layer mask to it. Photoshop does a great job. The mask is not perfect, but not bad for one click. And the secret that we professionals have is that if something is too difficult to select, we just disregard it and we paint it back in digitally. This is what we're going to do next. The first step is to mask out hair that we don't want to include. So select the brush tool, then paint with black on hairs that are too difficult to select, and then paint them back in digitally to make them more realistic. There's two ways of doing that. Let me show you both. I'm going to create a new layer and I'm going to paint single hair strands using the brush tool. From the brush settings, I'll set the brush size to 1 pixel, the spacing to 1%. And if you have a Wacom tablet, enable the shape dynamics and set the size jitter control to pen pressure. I'm currently using a Wacom tablet, and what I'll do is I'll hold Alt on Windows, Option on the Mac to temporarily activate the eyedropper tool, and I can select a color found on her hair, and I can now paint in that hair in digitally, like so. So that you can see what I'm doing, I'll zoom in by tapping on the Z key, and you can see how I'm just painting in these strands of hair. And as you paint, keep sampling from the original hair color so that you can have hair strands of different colors, and also follow the hair strands that are already there and noticeable just to keep everything looking more realistic. And obviously you can keep following this technique all around your hair to get a better result. The second technique is to use a brush made out of actual hair. Start by creating a new layer underneath your model. Then I'll double click on the hand tool to fit the image to screen, and I'll select a brush that I already have saved in my libraries panel. I'll search for it. It's called Hair. Here it is. And now when I paint, you'll see that I have this hair strand. Now for the sake of time, I'm not gonna go over how this brush was made, but I recently published a video on masking tips where I showed how I created it step by step. So I'll place a link to that Photoshop tutorial below in the description so that you can check it out. In that video, I also share a link to the brush so that you can download it and use it in your projects. But anyway, this is the brush that I'm going to use. I'm going to undo that, and I'll reduce my brush size by tapping on the left bracket key on the keyboard. And you can see a preview of it there. So that the hair matches my model, I will need to make some adjustments, so I'll click on the brush settings button from the options bar. Under brush tip, I'm going to flip it on the X axis so that the hair is facing the other way. Now I'm going to use the left arrow key on the keyboard to rotate the brush. I could also rotate it from the options bar under the angle option, and if you're in an older version of Photoshop, you can only rotate it from the brush settings. But anyway, I'm going to rotate and resize the brush to make it match as best as possible, and I'll click once to add the hair strand before and after. And as you can see, that makes this mask look a lot more realistic since we're painting in hair strands instead of masking them, which a lot of times is more difficult and it doesn't look as good. In this next tip, I'm going to show you what I do to finalize my composites and make them look more cohesive. First, I do one of two things. I either put all my layers into a smart object, but in a composite like this that has a lot of layers and a lot of smart objects already, I will copy all the layers into one flattened layer. There's an easy way to do that. You can press Control Alt Shift E on Windows, Command Option Shift E on the Mac, and we create this layer that is just a flattened version of all the other layers. And I usually call this layer Final, and I convert it into a smart object. And the reason that I'm converting this to a smart object is because I'm going to apply some color effects and I want to be able to edit them. Also, if I decide to change something in my composite, I can copy all the layers and paste them inside of the smart object to update it. So I'm still working with a smart object, even though this is my final step. Next, go into Filter, Camera, Raw Filter, and we can treat our composite as a single photo and we can adjust the color, tonality, and other things in our photo. For example, I can add a little bit of contrast, darken up the shadows a little bit, maybe even cool the image a bit more, add a little bit of texture, maybe even clarity, which is contrast and edge pixels, add vibrance, which is a smart way of adding saturation. It protects skin tones and already saturated pixels. And if you've been following me for a while, then you probably know that I always like to end my composites by adding a little bit of grain. If you zoom into the image, you'll see that it's quite blurry in some areas and it doesn't feel like an actual photo. So to make it feel more like a photo, I like to add just a tiny little bit of grain just to bring that film element back. Usually anywhere between 5 and 10, depending on the composite. Then I'll right click and fit the image to view and I'll add a vignette. And you can see my before and after. I think that it's very important to add a camera raw adjustment at the end of all your composites to make all the elements come together as one. By the way, if you find camera raw sluggish, it's probably because you don't have a powerful GPU. The GPU is an essential component when running Photoshop. If you look at the Adobe website, you can see a list of Photoshop features that require a GPU for acceleration, which includes camera raw. In other words, these features can be very slow without a powerful GPU. Also, some features will not work without a GPU. The laptop that I'm currently using contains the powerful Nvidia GeForce RTX 2080 Super with 8 GB of video memory. Best of all, Nvidia has creative app partnerships with Adobe, Blackmagic, Autodesk, and more to bring GPU accelerated improvements to your favorite creative software, including Photoshop. So make sure that you check out the MSI Creator 15. The link is below in the description. After you spend hours on a composite, it can be difficult to spot mistakes. To see your composite in a new light, try out this next trick. It's a lot like flipping a paper upside down when you're drawing to spot mistakes. In Photoshop, all you need to do is go into View and select Flip Horizontal. And that flips the image horizontally, of course, and it shows you your composite in a new way, and hopefully you can spot mistakes. Now, it's very important to note that we're not transforming pixels. This is just a preview. So if you were to save and close this file, then open it up again, you would see the original composite and not the flip version because we're not transforming pixels. We're just changing the way we look at them. The old way of doing this was to go into Image, Image Rotation, and flip the canvas horizontally. And this command actually transforms pixels. So Photoshop will have to calculate the transformation and that could take some time on larger files in slower computers. But now all you need to do is go into View and select Flip Horizontal and it happens automatically. So let me know in the comments which were your favorite compositing tips. And if you saw one that will help you in your workflow, remember to hit that like button and subscribe if you're new to the Photoshop training channel. Again, I would like to thank MSI for sponsoring today's Photoshop tutorial. If you haven't already, make sure to check out the MSI Creator 15 laptop, which is designed for creators, but it is also a well-rounded system for everyday users and gamers. Spec-wise, it's equipped with a 2.3 GHz Intel i7 8-core processor, 32 GB of RAM, and the powerful Nvidia GeForce RTX 2080 Super with 8 GB of video memory. And of course, a 4K display that can reproduce Adobe RGB at 100%. The link to this laptop is below in the description.